Amen. Wonderful lesson. You have your Bibles with you. You could be turning to the book of 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter number 6. And we're going to begin reading in the first verse. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And we're going to begin reading in the first verse. As you're turning there, as always, remember me. Being found in the will of the Lord is critical to preaching. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, I'm sorry, I said the first verse. Drop down to verse 7 with me. 1 Corinthians 6 and verse 7. Now therefore there is utterly a fault among you, because you go to the law one with another. Why do you rather take wrong? Why do you rather suffer yourselves to be defrauded? Nay, you do wrong and defraud that your brethren. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you, but ye are washed, but ye are sanctified, but ye are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ by the Spirit of our God. All things are lawful unto me, but all things are not expedient. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under the power of any.
Amen.
I'd like to preach, the Lord be my helper, on the thought, why do you prefer to lie? Dear Lord, we thank you for this goodness, Lord. We thank you for your mercy and grace. Lord, we thank you this morning for another year that you've laid out before us. And we pray that it be a year noted to be a time of revival for your people. Lord, we pray that it be a year to be noted when something began that we ourselves could only attribute to you. Lord, we pray that this would be a year that we would build things for your honor and for your glory. Lord, we pray that you would bless in all the endeavors of the church always, Lord. We pray that you would fill your house this morning with your Spirit, Lord, that you would cause us to look to things above. We pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, in a strange way this morning, we're going to be preaching on lying. There are many, many ways to lie, and there's many, many ways that we do lie. But the worst thing that you can do is lie to God. The worst possible thing that could be written of you is that you were a liar, and that unto God. And I think that we do that very much. And I think even today, in the day which we live, the way that lying is minimized makes it a great easier way to lie to God. To say, no, that isn't me. Or to say, yes, I'm saved. Or whatever your thoughts may be, it is still a lie. Now, sometimes it's very, very difficult not to lie. Like when your wife asks you, do you like this new dress? I mean, what are you going to say? What's going to be your response? But, you know, in all seriousness, we should be honest, you know. We should say, you know, that really doesn't bring out your full beauty. Or whatever you can do to give your opinion of a dress or whatever it may be. So it is our bent to lie anyway. And then the culture that we live in demands that we lie as well. And so it is a difficult thing to live in absolute truth. In verse 7, the Bible says, now therefore there is utterly a fault among you. And if you know the Corinthian letter, he took them apart piece by piece by piece and showed them exactly what was wrong. Now, he could have lost fellowship with the Corinthian church. It could have been that he would never see them again, but he thought it better to tell them the truth. And that should be our situation this morning, and every preaching man of God, if nothing else, tell them the truth. Get the truth out there. And so he says, now therefore there is utterly a fault among you because you go to the law one with another. Now, listen, the things that happen at New Testament Baptist Church is that it should stay here. We don't need to be publicizing when there is difficulty among the church. It's no one else's business but our business. Now, we live in a day and age, again, that little tongue of ours, we go out and say, do you know what she said? Do you know what he did? Did you see what she was wearing today? And on and on and on it could go. Now, the church at Corinth was having this very same problem, but it had gone a step further, and they were taking it to the law of the land. Now, we have no business doing that as the Lord's people. It needs to be settled here. In other words, we don't sue one another. That's not what God's people are about. But you think about it in and of yourself, and we've seen this. Why do you not rather take wrong? Why do you not suffer for yourselves to be defrauded? In other words, why do you just not handle it? Now, the reason we don't handle it is this, is we don't have the courage to handle it. If I had an issue with somebody, it takes a great deal, just like when Donna asked me, do you like this dress? It takes a great difficulty to say, no, that isn't the best dress that I've ever looked at. And it takes far more courage to say, you know what? I have an issue with you. It takes a lot of strength and a lot of guidance. Now, I'll say this. Most of the time, it's not a real issue. It is not a real thing. And that is the reason we're kind of a little embarrassed to take it before them, because we really know it doesn't make a difference anyway. We're just there to pick apart and cause a problem. Because if it's enough of an issue, you need to go to them. The Bible is very clear. The Lord Jesus in His own ministry says, do you have a fault one with another? Say it to Him. And if it cannot be resolved, let it be established between two or three of the brethren, and if it can't be resolved, take it before the whole church. Now, the reason that we don't do this, and I've heard a lot of people try to stamp this out, but the real reason is this: it really doesn't matter anyway, and deep down within our heart, we know it. So we're embarrassed. So why not just, you know, talk about them and get behind their back and gouge a little bit? And the reason we don't take it before the church is this: when it arrived and we know everybody thinks it's stupid, we would be embarrassed, right? So take it to them and do it as the Bible commands us to. That's what Paul was saying, that the law of the land has nothing to do with the church. Verse 9. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Now, if you underline in your Bible, you get that one down, because it's not changed in the years of grace. The unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God. In other words, grace is not a license to sin. Grace is not a reason to say, hey, I'm saved so I can drink like a brewery. I'm saved so I can run after another woman if I so wish. I'm saved so I can defraud my brother and get up a little bit of money from him. I'm saved. I'm saved. So Paul was being very clear to them that those that die in sin, die in sin. In other words, you know what? The fruits of righteousness will bear out. And as Brother Junior taught, we do have the flesh to contend with. I understand that. But over and all, we should have a good testimony.
Yeah. Amen.
We should have a good testimony. And so he gets more specific and he says, be not deceived. Now, deceived comes from lying, and that's why we're preaching on is lying, is that people will lie to you, and you will lie to yourself. Deception is a wonderful big lie. That's all deception is someone lying and giving you a little hocus pocus to make you believe that lie. It is just a well-dressed, well-thought-out, well-planned lie. That's what being deceived is all about. And we live in a day and age where I think many of us ought to be deceived because being deceived is easier than the truth. Now notice what it says. Be not deceived, neither fornicators, and that's a man and a woman having a sexual relationship after outside the bond of marriage, neither fornicators, nor idolaters. You know what? I wouldn't be a missionary to Muslim people if I didn't believe that. Because idolaters will go to hell. People that worship dead things and trees. We just got through the Christ Mass, and you wouldn't believe some of the people I saw having their family pictures made in front of a Christmas tree. You know what that is? That's idolatry. Plain and simple, idolatry. And so we see the Bible says very clearly that those people are... And listen, I know what it is to be deceived. I was deceived of that mess for 25 years. But see, what happened is the Lord showed me, and I got rid of it. That's the difference. We shouldn't be caught up in that mess. And I really won't get too deeply into the Christ Mass today. That's not my purpose. But I do want you to see that idolatry is a very real thing. It still exists today. Then he says, nor adulterers, people that break their marriage bond, have a sexual relationship with someone else. Then it says, nor effeminate. Now, I want you to see this effeminate people, it will go to sodomy in the next example, but it starts out with men trying to be effeminate. To be sissy. To be like, you know what? If one of my boys was being a sissy, what they need to do is get out and do something different. You know, the Lord hasn't given us a whole lot. I know this. He's given us what we can handle because that's how blessings go. But you know what? I worked a whole lot. But well, Donna says, boys, get out of the house. And go, you've got 17 acres. Knock yourself out. And you know what? It was good for them. They didn't need to be laid up under the house and in front of the TV for hours and hours and hours and sifting through the internet on and on and on. Because you know what? It makes them effeminate. And if that's not stopped, it will grow into sodomy. We don't need our boys to be sissies. They need to be like men, right? And so we see then that we see that goes into a class, remember, that won't inherit the kingdom of God. And you know why? Because it doesn't speak of true redemption. People don't like that today. Now notice what it says. Or abusers of themselves with mankind. So it's going a little further into sexual relationships between the same sex. Nor thieves, nor covetousness, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. So there's no doubting it that this is part of the lies that are out there today. You hear sodomites say, well, I can't help it. That's how God made me. And I'm not sure about that, but all I can say, if that's true, there are vessels of wrath, and Esau's purpose was for God to pour out his wrath upon him. That was his purpose. So I don't know, but I do know this, that people that are so caught up in this sin will not inherit the kingdom of God. And that wants to be disputed today, and even to the filth of saying, God made me this way. Well, like I said, he may have made you a vessel of wrath, but it doesn't speak Our rebellion is what makes sin. Verse 11. Now such were previously before, and such were some of you, but ye are washed, but ye are sanctified, but ye are justified. Now notice those three things. But ye are washed. You know, it's a marvelous, wonderful thing that the blackness of our sin can be washed in red and come out just as white and pure as cotton. That's what He does in the redemption. That's why a blood sacrifice is necessary. And if you've not been washed, you're still lost. If you've not been washed in the crimson flow, you're still on your way to hell, even this morning, if you're not washed. Now notice what else it says. But ye are, if you're not washed, but ye are sanctified. Now there's a lot of discrepancy about sanctification. And I think we've minimized sanctification. And I believe holiness people may have taken it a little bit too far. But I do want you to see this. You have to be sanctified. A lot of people say, well, that just means set apart for a purpose. And I understand what they're saying. We are saved for a reason to glorify God. But let me say this. Sanctification goes further. You can't wallow around in sin. Sanctification takes you out of that. I don't believe in progressive sanctification, which many holiness people do. They just get better and better until one time they arrive. I don't believe that, but listen, sanctification is a necessary thing. In fact, if sanctification's not there, I don't think redemption's there either. I don't believe that you can... I don't believe it will fall out in the Bible any other way. And then the last thing He says, but you're washed, but you're sanctified, but ye are justified. Now that justified goes back to the law, and being justified means we are just with God, that we are in alignment. And so if all these things are not in evidence in your life, the only thing that I can come to is that you're not justified. So I want you to see that the lie is this. You can do what you want to. You can go where you want to go. You can do as you please and still be saved. Listen, there's nothing farther from the truth. You know, this is what I'll even go this far. I almost rather people believe in baptismal redemption than to believe garbage like that. And you know what? You know where that came from? Just Arminian doctrine. Oh, all I have to do is ask the Lord to forgive me and still live in the filth and the disgustingness of this world. You know what? We need to understand that fruits go with redemption. Fruits follow salvation. And so we see then that the devil is going to lie to you. He's going to sell you a bill of goods. He's going to lie to your spirit because he's very crafty at lying. Now go with me back to Genesis chapter 3. And some people will say that the first sin is covetousness. I think the first sin was a lie. Notice Genesis chapter 3 in the first verse. Now the serpent was more subtle or sly or smart than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, have God said ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, ye may eat of the garden. We may eat of the garden, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst or the middle of the garden, God has said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. Now, just as an interjection here, then we have to come to this. Really, who told the first lie? Adam. Right? Because that's not what the Lord said, was it? He says, I don't want you to eat it. So I don't know if he didn't trust Eve, if he saw a little weakness about Eve, or thought he knew more than God, or what his sin was, but he added something to it. You need to be very cautious when people begin to add to the Word of God. It isn't a good thing. You can't improve on that book. That makes sense? So when people begin to add things and do things, and you know, I'm going to be real honest, what I have seen, what most people add to is the teachings of the church. And I won't get too deeply into that, but listen, a church is what a church is, but its authority goes beyond that. Does that make sense? And so we see then that, and I'll interject this and I'll move on. And who has always added more to the church than any other thing? The Catholics, right? So adding to the church, not that there's not church truth, but adding to that truth beyond this book, you will get into trouble. And so we see then that the first lie was an additional lie, meaning that, oh, he added to the truth. Well, that's still a lie. He improved it. He was doing it for Eve's protection. No, it is still a lie. And when we add something to make it better, it's still a lie. Notice verse 4, and the serpent said unto the woman, you shall not surely die. So we find Adam adding something, and then we find the serpent questioning the authority of God. That's what he was really doing. He wasn't saying, I invite you to do this. He was, because what had God said? God said, in the day that you eat of there, ye shall die. So he was questioning God. We have no authority whatsoever to question God. One thing I've seen a lot of people, what about little children that die in Ethiopia? You know, the only thing I'd say is, I don't know, and you don't know either. If I thought they were okay, I will say this, I wouldn't send a missionary to them, because what most people would say to that answer would just make them guilty. So why would I deliberately send them to hell? You know what I'll have to say? The only scripture whatsoever dealing with children is when David said, he can't come to me, but I can go to him, concerning about the first son by Bathsheba. That's the only thing you'll find anywhere. That makes sense? And so why would we add to it? So what was really happening is that the devil was lying to God's people. It seemed like he was just questioning it, but what he really was doing was lying. Verse 5, for God doeth know that in the day that you eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and you shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And I won't go too deeply into that, but I believe Adam was there for the whole thing. And so we see then, we as the Lord's people need to be very aware of lies. We need to be very aware when people question things. We need to be very, very aware what we believe is pure truth and not just something man has told us and we've accepted so long that we assume it's truth. You know what? If it's not thus saith the Lord, the only thing I can say is somebody's lied to you. Right? Somewhere along the way, you have been lied to. Now go with me to 1 Corinthians. And again, this is the church that really Paul picked apart piece by piece. And nothing down on the Corinthian church. I think sometimes all of our churches would be do good to get picked apart by the Lord Jesus Christ or somebody someone that understands this. But notice what it says. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 32. 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 32. The Bible says, If after manner of men I have fought with beasts as Ephesus, if after the manner of men I have fought with beasts at Ephesus. Now, one or two things happened. He literally was thrown into an arena with beasts such as lions, which is a distinct possibility because they wanted him dead. Or there were people out there so opposing the truth that they presented like beasts. And I've seen more of them than I have seen the real lions, haven't you? People that just are such a hater of truth that they come at you in your face concerning what they, really what they do is they hate the truth that we possess. And so he says, I have done that. Then he says, what advantage hath it me if the dead rise not? Now, the real question, somebody was saying, when you're dead, that's it. Now, if you know your Bible, that was a Sadduceal doctrine. The Sadducees said that there is no resurrection. And so that was drifting into the church, and it was setting up its abode. And so Paul begins to answer it. And he says, well, if that's the case, let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. Be not deceived. Again, that there is a lie out there. There is a lie presenting itself. There is a lie that happens. And you know what? Russellite people, they are not Jehovah's Witnesses. We are the witnesses of the great God Jehovah. They'll tell you there is no resurrection. Should that not give us a heads up? Should that not give us a concern and say, hey, they're denying a tenet of the faith. That they say that when you're dead, you're dead. In fact, they advocate cremation, which is the most heathen practice you can find. They advocated. I've never known a Russellite to die that wasn't cremated. And so we see then that we as the Lord's people ought to be aware and not be deceived. Be not deceived. Evil communication corrupt good manners. Now, I've heard this preached all my life, and I think they missed the boat. Now, every one of us has got a little swap on the leg or in the mouth when our mama said to us, mind your manners. In other words, you come in, listen, you're being disrespectful. You're saying things that are an embarrassment to me. That is not what it's saying. A lot of people say, well, this verse seems to be out of order. Oh, no, it's not at all out of order. It's right where it needs to be because he says, be not deceived. Evil communications corrupt good manners. You know what manners is? It's orderly conduct. That's what manners means. And so, if we have false teachings that's telling us that we can live and do as we please, that corrupts us, does it not? What does it say in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 concerning the church? Let everything be done decently and in order, right? So if we're out here flopping on the ground and screaming and stuff, is that good order? And Pentecostal people will defend that to the ninth degree, and they can say what they want to. That's not orderly conduct. They're not minding their manners. Does that make sense? And we should have that testimony among God's people that we are an orderly group. We're a group that follows the things of Christ. We have good manners. Verse 34, he makes it even more correct, more clear. Awake. Wake up, don't go to sleep, awake to righteousness. We get back to that same separation, do we not? Awake to righteousness, look like saved people, act like saved people. And this church was so wicked, they had a man in there that was committing fornication with his stepmother, and they were defending it to the ninth degree. If you don't believe me, read 1 Corinthians 5 for your Bible study this week, and you'll find that I'm right. You'll find that I'm telling you the truth. They were defending it. And so we find here, he goes back to the core of the matter and says, don't let nobody lie to you. Don't let nobody deceive you. Evil communications. You know what? The worst thing we can do for our children is let them watch and listen to whatever they want to. Because listen, evil communications is out there. They don't need this world's music. They don't need this world's filthy TV. They don't need it. That's an evil communication. That's a communication that will corrupt them. Evil communication corrupt good manners. Awake to righteousness and sin not, for some have not the knowledge of God. And so why do we do this? Why do we want to be separate? Why do we want to be different? Some people don't know the truth. That's why we want to do it. It's not to make us look good and somebody say, oh, see how holy they are? No, no. Ladies, when you walk into the grocery store and you have a garment that pertaineth to a woman, I'll guarantee you anybody in here said something about it over the years. Asked you something about it. Now, 9 times out of 10, to our shame, I had 2 different Pentecostal women run up to me because of the girls and say, where do you go to church? And I'll say, well, I pastor New Testament Baptist Church in Dover, and they leave you like a defeated puppy. But see, it said something to somebody, didn't it? That's a form of communication. Listen, when you walk away, I will never forget this. I won't use people. But a man that me and him butted heads for a long, long time, he got on my nerves and I got on his nerves. And every time he'd come in the nursing home, I would just shudder because I knew he would have something smart to say before he left that building. And knowing my nature, I would answer him with something. And that's not a good thing. But that's how it always went. One day, here he comes into my office. I'm like, here we go again. And he says, Larry, I want to tell you something. You have one of the finest boys that I've ever met. When that filth starts at the factory, he walks away and finds something else to do. See, that Matthew did something that made a testimony, did he not? He didn't want evil communications. He didn't want that filth around him. So he walked away, and this person that I didn't like much and he didn't like me, it made an impression on him. Do you see what I'm saying? There's a reason to be separate from this present evil world. Don't be deceived. Grace is not a license to sin. Awake to righteousness, sin not, for some have not the knowledge of God. I speak this to your shame. In other words, they were living like dogs. Follow the whole book of 1 Corinthians, you'll find that's true. Thou fool, that which thou sowest is not quickened, except it die. And it goes into more truth concerning what they were sowing out. Galatians. Paul writes to the church of Galatia. They had the very same problem. Galatians chapter 6, beginning in verse 6. Galatians 6, verse 6. Now, I will interject this concerning the Galatian letter. Read chapter 1, and their real problem was this, that they were holding on to works for salvation. Galatians 6 in the first verse, let him that is taught in the word communicate unto him that teaches all good things. Be not deceived, don't be lied to, in the world, in the word, don't be lied into in situation. Be not deceived, God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. So people that are going around and living like dogs and saying, oh yes, I'm saved, I just don't come to church. Oh yes, I'm saved. Mammy back in 1942 led me to the Lord, whatever that means. And on you could go, but they have lived like a dog the entirety of their life. Everybody says they'll reap it in the next generation, and I know what they're saying. The Bible says the sin of the father will be on to the third and fourth generation. But this is the real deal. They'll reap it in hell. They'll reap it in hell. I have no confidence in those people. You say, oh, Brother Larry, you're judging. No,
When we plant corn, I anticipate corn to come up, don't you? And if something else come up, something is wrong. Right? Something's not right. And so we find then that don't be deceived. If you have a drive and a desire and it doesn't bother you to sin, something is wrong. Something's horribly wrong. Something's amiss. You've been deceived somehow. If you can lay down and wallow in the filth of this world and it never concerned you, something is wrong. It doesn't play out. There's nothing there that speaks of redemption. There's nothing that speaks of salvation. If you're happy in the hog lot, you know what I'll have to say? It's your hog. That's the only thing I can come to. And so we see then that, and I'll give you two examples of that and I'll move on. The prodigal wasn't happy there, was he? But the Bible says in 1 Peter, the dog is returned to its vomit, and the sow to her wallowing. You know what? Because that was their nature. That's what pulled them there. That's who they were. Verse number 7. Be not deceived, God is not mocked, for whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption, but he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap everlasting life. Now, a lot of people don't like that verse, and I've seen it stepping around and literally skipped over in scriptural reading in Baptist churches, and the reason is this, it makes it sound like you plant something and you harvest down the road. Well, you know what? That's exactly what it says. Now, does that mean, I'll work and do and tend my garden and I'll be redeemed? No. But if you have a garden, you will work it. Right? And people that are not redeemed, they have a garden, the inward man, but they could care less about it. Right? Don't tend it. Don't plant nothing. Just let it go and let it go. Listen, I really can't have any hope that these people are genuinely redeemed. Verse 9. And let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. Two things. It's a weary day. Listen, I pray we are in the last of the last days. Yeah. I pray that to be true. And notice I didn't say I know that to be true, because the truth is I don't. I hope it will be, but I don't know that. But it says that don't be weary, for we shall reap if we faint not. So we find another thing, people telling you, all you do is have to trust Jesus and everything's going to be fine. Say the sinner's prayer with me. Y'all think that's foolish, talking to Joey? Well, I've seen him talk to people just with the same mentality as Joey. Right? And I know what they're saying, but listen, it doesn't make it true. And you know what? If they do that and the Lord does great redemption in their life and they live the entirety of their days for the cause of Christ, all I can say is yes, they were saved. But if they live like dogs and they never do anything for the kingdom of God, all I can say is they didn't get nothing. Right? And a lot of people today is very, very afraid to make those statements. But I believe that to fall out in the world of the Word of God. If we desire worldly things, something is wrong. You know, if I have a desire to borrow one of Donna's skirts, something is terribly wrong. So why would we reverse it to the other side? Why would it be all right for Donna to put on a pair of my britches if the other is not essentially the same wrong? And it is. And you know why women desire that?
Because they have the same kind of flesh as I do. 1930s, it began to be a little bit more accepted. And here we are 80 years later. And it's routine. In fact, if you preach on it, people get mad at you. You know what? Brother Terry was telling me one day that he was in Lowe's buying some paint. And that a person passed by him in a skirt. And he said, I took a double take, and it was a man. What's the difference? What's the difference? I think that's about 5 years ago, and now they're wanting us to share bathrooms, right? What's the difference? What's the difference? Right? So you see, when you open that gate to sin, everything is going to run through it. And you know why? Because that's our nature. That is the carnal nature, and it's what the fleshly man desires. And so hang in there, and we will read. 2 Timothy, Paul writing to try to encourage young Timothy with the church he was pastoring. Best I can tell from the Word of God, he pastored Ephesus Baptist Church. And he was discouraged. People were no doubt poking him a little bit because of his youngness. 1 Timothy chapter 3, in verse 10, the Bible says, but thou hast fully known my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, charity, patience. Now, I'm not going to hit on each one of those, but I want you to see, you've known my doctrine, and you've known my life. You've known who I am. I'm sorry, I'm reading the wrong verse, aren't I? Chapter 3. No, that's the right verse. 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 10. But thou hast fully known my doctrine in my life, and the life is very important. Persecutions, afflictions, which came from Antioch, at Iconium, at Lystra, what persecutions I endured, but out of them the Lord delivered me. And so I want you to see, first of all, you may fall into those, but people know you by some way, and if you're not known, if you don't have those things, you will fall when things like verse 11 come up. Verse 12, yea, all that will live godly in Christ shall suffer persecution. Write that down, because you will. And what I've found in my short ministry is this, is people label me as a legalist. All your teaching, and I won't get into names, but a lady that left here recently, she said, all you ever preached on is separation. Well, good. Maybe if you get that right, I'll preach on something else. Right? People don't like that today. You know what I found? If you preach on the lofty things of God, such as predestination and the Lord's churches, they're like, woo! But if you get down right where we live and you read things like, set no evil thing before thine eye, they're done with you. They're done with you. And so we see that we need to be a Christ-centered people. Verse 13, but evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. Now, I want you to see that there are a group of people out there trying to tell you you can live and do as you please. And listen, you're on your way to glory. You know what their message is? It's a message of deception. They are deceiving hundreds. And then it says, in addition to them deliberately deceiving, it says that they were being deceived. Somebody once asked me, would you think the Pope is saved? And I answered, no. I still don't. I don't think he's a redeemed man. It's changed since then. We have there's a different Pope today than there was then. But no, I don't think they're saved. But I do want you to see this. He was a deceiver. And he's still deceiving people today. Deceived people deceive. And you know why? That's the only direction they can go if Christ doesn't intervene. Right. Deceiving and being deceived. And instead of getting mad about the situation then, we should just present the truth and leave it there and let God do with it whatever whatever pleaseth Himself to do. Verse 14. But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. Two things, keep going, keep going, keep going. Don't give up. And then the last thing it says, know whom you've learned them. And Paul wasn't talking about himself. He had been a colleague with Timothy. He brought Timothy up. He encouraged Timothy. He knew Timothy's grandmother. He knew Timothy's mother. He knew him probably the entirety of his life. But he didn't learn that from Paul. He learned it from Christ. And I'll even go a step further. You better know whom you've learned something from. Mm-hmm. Because you know what? If it don't coincide with the Bible, I don't care if Brother Blah Blah taught you, it's still wrong. Right? Mm-hmm. Still wrong. I don't care if you practiced it for 80 years. If it's wrong, if it doesn't coincide with the Bible, it's wrong. Right? And so we see then that Timothy wasn't convinced of Paul. Timothy was convinced of the Lord God, of the things that he was settled upon. Verse 15, and from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to know the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith that is in Jesus Christ. So I ask you this morning, are you deceived? Do you really know that you know that you know? You know, another deception is somebody messing with the doctrines of predestination. You know why I go out on Saturdays when I can and preach the gospel? It's because I don't know the elect. All it said to me in the Word of God is to go and preach. So when someone asks you concerning their soul, my brother Junior taught, listen, they're babes. They don't need to hear about predestination. They don't need to hear about the specifics of the Lord's church and the Lord's bride. They need the gospel. Simple truth of God, the gospel. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and ye shall be saved. That's what they need. Right? And so I ask you this morning, do you know that you're saved? Do you know that you've been born again? It's very important that you settle that in your heart once, now, and forever.